So the first question you want us to talk about is how Christian first got interested in falconry. How did you read about it or
I can't remember. But I was always interested in nature, and from a point on, I don't know when it started, to be interested in birds of prey. And then of course I heard somewhere and sometime about falconry, and this of course took me immediately.
So then you enlarged, you found books.
Yes, but I couldn't do it. I just started after the war in 1950 or so.
Yes.
To do real, just to try to be a falconer, which took a couple of years longer. Yeah.
And was there much falconry going on after the war in Germany?
No, I don't think so. Mm. Not much, but there were very few falconers. But it took some time before I met them, because I had to start just on my own. I had no idea how to do it, and it was a good thing that I got a book of Franz Waller after years, and I learned a lot out of it and didn't make too many mistakes.
I'm sure very few.
No, of course.
But of course, you learn by mistakes.
Yes, the first good goshawk I had in 1954, which is quite a long time ago.
Yes.
But I was not a very young boy anymore, you know.
No, but it was hard times after the war.
Yes, and I would have liked to have a very good goshawk, because we had lots of rabbits and were very hungry. And nobody was allowed to shoot, to use a gun after the war, yeah. And but this was not the idea when I started. I just think about it just now, you know.
Yeah. Mm. And so your first hawk was the goshawk?
Was a goshawk, yes.
And they were easy to get then?
Yes, but I got one. I mean, the first one I got from the zoological garden. They had the young one, and I saw it. It couldn't stand already, even though it was fully feathered. And I had three little birds. I don't know how you call them, Zwerg or Dommeln. Mm. You know, these animals which are living in the reeds.
The
big ones, yes, but they are small ones.
Water rail.
Ones also.
Maybe a water rail?
Little bit.
And I had three little ones I just raised, and they were interested, and I said, if you give me this goshawk, I'll give you the three little birds.
Oh, I see.
And so I had my first goshawk, and she started to be a horrible screamer, and it was... for our neighbors, it was not very nice.
I'm sure.
So I was, at the end, I was glad when she disappeared. She got wild and went back to the wild. So
right.
And this was a poor beginning.
Yeah, we all have poor beginnings, eh? It's how we learn.
No. In 1954, I went to the eastern part of Germany with a friend, and we found immediately a goshawk's nest, and we took three young goshawks, two for my friends, Tiersels, and one female for myself. And she was very good. She was the first one to be very good.
Good. So that gave, then as soon as you have a good one, then you get more enthusiastic, don't you?
Oh yes, and I never wanted to have a Peregrine falcon or a falcon at all, because I was reading in the book that you can't catch a lot of prey with a Peregrine falcon, and they always get lost. So I said, never a Peregrine falcon.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
But then you've had a series of great ones.
Yes, a friend of mine, the Dr. Hauf, he wanted to have one, and he got one from the east part of Germany. And then he got very ill and had to go to hospital, and he said, you have to train this falcon, because it's just the age.
Yes.
Where it has to be trained. Oh, so I said, no, please don't. And after a while I said, oh yes, but please don't blame me if it's going away.
Yes.
And so this was the first Peregrine falcon I had, and I started to fly him, made a lot of mistakes, but was able to catch my first partridge with it. After that, went back to the wild. So that was the beginning. I was hooked to the Peregrine, of course.
Yes.
And I've seen so many mistakes which all elderly falconers did, so I learned a lot of this. Mm.
And, because there wasn't many good peregrines in Germany at that time.
No. Nothing. Yeah. I mean, I shouldn't say that, but this is the truth. Mm. And then I got a peregrine by a friend of mine, Dr. Kost, who was a good falconer, but not very successful. But this tiercel I got was taken by pigeon people from the nest and taken by the police because, well, it was a legal young one and given to Dr. Kost, and he flew this tiercel for 3 years. Not successfully, but very wild. He was going out on the day and coming back in the evening, and this happened a long time. And then he had to go to expedition in the South Sea. No, in the Red Sea, not the South Sea, in the Red Sea. And he asked me, would you like to have this tiercel? And I said, yes, please. Yes. And this was my very good first peregrine tiercel.
Gustav.
No, that was Life.
Life, yes. I remember reading about Life.
He was a revolution in our Falconer scene, because I went to a meeting and I could catch partridges.
Yes.
And pheasants, even pheasants was a tiercel. Right. So that was the first one. I had him until he was five, and I gave him back to Dr. Kost, who came back.
Right.
So the next one was a young tiercel from, I think he was from Scotland.
Right.
Because he was given to Dr. Witt by Ronald Digby. Maybe I shouldn't say all these things, but Otto Witt said, oh, I don't want this one. Would you like to have it? And I said, I have one. That was still when I had life.
Yes.
And I don't need two. So, and he said, oh yes, please take him, and I took him, and he was one of my best partners ever.
Wow.
He was great.
Yeah.
Anyway, so it started.
And that was Gustav?
That was Eric.
Eric?
Eric, yes. Yeah. He died when he was in his fourth year, I think, of pesticides.
Yeah, because that was the time.
Yes, he got cramps, and this was the time when all the peregrines died, even in human hands and in the wild, of course.
Yes.
And I think this was his fate. Then I had to go to Africa for 7 months or so, so it was a break there. And afterwards, that was your stuff, yes.
Yes.
He was one of the very famous folk.
He's the first one I remember my father talking about.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So he always talks Gustav, Christian and Gustav.
Yes, and he was the father of many, many young peregrines.
He started the breeding?
No, not he. I started the breeding with another pair, which were not used for falconry in 74. But in 76, I used Gustav for artificial insemination for the first time successfully. And from this time, we had so many young falcons from Gustav by insemination with different females, and which helped us to start the whole breeding for release. You know,
re-release project.
Yeah, that was really the idea. Mm. And of course, to have young peregrines for falconry.
Yeah, as well.
Of course, as well, yeah.
And where did Gustav come from? Was he German?
Gustav, he came from Norway. I think he was taken by a man and given to Otto Witt again.
All right.
And Otto Witt, this was a horrible screamer.
Oh.
He was screaming the whole day, and especially if you could see him, he could see somebody, he started screaming, and Otto said, I can't keep this dog. This is this hall. And I said, I don't want one. And then I thought, maybe I'll never get another one like this. Mm-hmm. And I took him. And he lived up to 16 and was used for 13 years for falconry. Mm-hmm. And was a real successful bird and the first one which I flew in Scotland.
Yes.
Yes.
So when was your first trip to Scotland?
1970.
Yeah.
1970. Stephen Frank. Mm. Everybody knows him in the Falconry Society, and he asked me. I met him first in 59, so we were, for many years, we were friends.
Yes.
And walked together before, but he, in 1970, asked me to come to Scotland, which I did. And
I think before then you came to a meeting. I
was reading the British Falconers meeting, I think that was the first international meeting of the British Falconers Club. And when I was there, I got the message from Stephen, please come up to Scotland, but I have to go back to Berlin to university. I had my job there, I couldn't couldn't have more days free, so I said next year I will come, and I did in 1970. Hmm. And this was the beginning of my Scottish adventure.
And your first year was on Frumster? Is that right?
No, the first year was on Stephen's Moor, with Stephen. The second year was together with Stephen, and the third year was Thrumster.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then you moved to Campster.
Campster, which was the most famous moor for me, and it was a traditional Falkner's moor. Mm. So I felt quite honored to be able to hunt there, and we had a lot of extremely good days there together with others, especially with your father, and who had the moor not very far from there, and we had very often we walked together. And Stephen, of course. Stephen came up every second day and stayed up with his dogs, which he put in his kennel. And this time he had quite a lot of dogs because he was still lending them for shooting,
and that was still the time you were borrowing dogs from Steve because of quarantine.
Yes, so you couldn't bring our own dogs, which was a shame.
I remember Tiggy.
Tiggy was a great dog, no obedience at all, but very good finding grouse. You had to follow Tiggy. Tiggy would never follow you. You had to follow her, but she was so good that you could follow her because she was finding grouse, pointing them and flushing them at the right moment. Yeah. She was great. She was really great. Stephen always gave to me his best dogs, and that was very kind of him.
He was very kind with everybody who was coming over.
Giving the best dog.
Yeah, you had
because
the best.
He also wanted to do falconry, and we did it together, of course.
Yes.
Yes, many dogs followed after that. But when we were able to bring them from Germany, the first one was, I don't know exactly which year it was, but Stephen didn't believe it, that it was possible. He said, you can't bring a dog to England, you will be punished. I said, Stephen, I know better. You go to British Airways, Inverness, I think it was Inverness. Oh, yes, I think it was Inverness. Yes. No, it was Edinburgh. He had to go to Edinburgh to collect her. He finally did it, and all right. So we had the first German-bred pointer, English pointer, in Scotland, and a few were following it, which were quite a success, I would say.
I remember some really good dogs.
I had, of course, Ada, for instance, was one of Stephen. He bred Ada. Mm-hmm. She was one of the most famous dogs. And we quarantined her back we haven't to do her in quarantine, but she went to Germany.
Yes.
And then we, after a while, we quarantined her back. There was no possibility to use her in Germany because no partridges anymore.
No.
And she was quite a successful dog.
I remember.
And Gero.
On three legs as well. She damaged her leg.
Yes. She had an injury in the shoulder and was. Yes, she was running on more or less on three legs. But she even beat the other dogs.
Yes,
she very often had the first point. Mm.
Yes, she had a very good nose.
Yeah. she was very.
And there was plenty of grouse in those days as well.
Oh yes, Kempster was. I mean, compared to nowadays, it was crowded with grouse, and if you go there now, it's all forested, and
awful.
The tears are coming. Yeah. I mean, it's horrible to see that.
All those moors that they forested, I hate going. Loch Doo is the same.
Because
we had some fantastic joint days on Loch Doo.
Loch Doo was great because the Italians took it for many years, and nobody was, or people who didn't see it, you can't imagine, because it was in the complete open, you could see this building like a castle just for miles.
Mm.
And it was very, very beautiful and so nice company, the Italian falconers and others were coming. Your father very often was there, and there are quite a lot of stories. Yes.
I can remember a great story. I think it was Tom or Gustav, you lost and went to Wick.
That was Gustav. I lost him for 5 days. But this was before, that was Stromstad. Yes. That was quite dramatic because I think we searched all Caithness and so many people helped.
And this was before telemetry.
Yes, and no telemetry, of course, yes. But many people, and we spoke to everybody we met in the field, and nobody had seen the pork. And I have given up, and I remember I was just taking a bath in the morning, and I said, so we have to go home without your stuff. And the police came. A police car came, and they said, the Falconer's living here? And my wife said, yes, of course, yeah. Oh, you know where your Falconer is? It's sitting on a high roof in the middle of Wick. It's a long story, but finally we got him back, and it's a really long story, but I don't want to tell it all. But the problem was I had one more day, and I said to my wife, I said, I'd like to fly him. And he said, no, you are not allowed to fly him anymore. It's the last day, and he was away. And I said, okay, if he's less than 700 grams, I'll fly him. And he was just 700 grams. So anyway, I flew him and was successfully, and everything ended quite well. So there were many years to come with him.
Yes. And then I remember, the first ones I remember you flying were Richard and Tom together. I can remember you coming to Amor, that was close by, and flying.
Yes. Yes. Tom, I think, was more successful, but I flew him more. And Richard was more stylish.
Yes,
was much nicer.
Even as a boy, I remember. Yeah.
And they got their names from for Tom Cade, a good friend we meet now, and the other one, Richard, from Richard Fife, who is another good friend of mine, a Canadian who's been very, very active in protection of peregrines.
Yes. Yeah. And you, you met both of them, and they helped you with your.
Oh,
reintroduction of peregrines in Germany.
Yes, we worked more or less together, and especially I got a very near connection to Richard Fife, but to Tom Cade also, but Richard Fife, I mean, sometimes it's just you get real friends. And
yes,
he came to Germany, and we went together to Spain to meet Felix de la Fuente and Hawk together, and it was a great time. A real great time.
Yes. It was a nice time because there was.
Hmm?
It was a nice time because there was real. There was not so many falconers, but fantastic friendship between.
Yes,
them.
That's true.
And there was lots of quarry. So.
Yes, and in Spain, of course, red leg partridges, which is not so nice. And I mean, it's good flights, but you don't need the dog work, and the dog work is for me very, very important. And for instance, you can't. You can't fly on grouse without a very good pointing dog. Yes. It's impossible.
Yeah.
And so the dog work is, for me, is one of the most important things of the whole hawking.
It's the biggest part.
Yes, yeah. I mean, the cooperation between, I start with the falcon, the dog, and the man.
Yes.
It's something very special.
But in fact, we spend more time looking at the dog's work than we do.
Absolutely. It's much more difficult to train a good dog than a good falcon.
Yeah. And you can't train a good falcon without a good dog.
This is also true, yes.
Yeah.
But if you have a very good falcon, you can even use a not so good dog, because but the beginning is better to have a trained dog. Some people start with a falcon and say, now we need a dog, which is the wrong way around.
Yeah. But it was a fantastic time for good dogs, that period as well.
Yeah.
Steve was reading some really
nice Steve stuff. Yes, I mean, yeah. For Steve was living with his dogs. There are pictures when he was on his couch with 7 dogs.
Yes. Yeah, for Steve, I think it got even the dogs became more important than the falconry, or at least
maybe,
on that level.
Maybe you're right. Yes, yes. I'd never thought about it, but this might be right.
Yeah. But he was so generous as well, because he gave dogs to everybody.
Yes,
not just lent for the when you couldn't bring dogs in, but he.
Yeah, he was.
We all had dogs of Stephen's breeding.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Missing Stephen and his dogs.
Yes. Yeah. And you did lots of work with the reintroduction, and was it a proper? There was no peregrines left in Germany at all when you.
No, that's not true. There was a very small population, rest population in southern Germany. There were about 40 pairs, but at this time they said about 20 pairs.
Right.
Now they start to decorating a bit because it's they love it more. Anyway, there were no peregrines left in the East Germany. Nothing, not a single one. And there were just this little rest population in southern Germany. Bavaria, a few, but all the north of Germany, north of the Main River, no peregrine anymore. So, and we were afraid that it would be the complete end of the peregrine, because even the rest population seemed to go down because they didn't have young anymore, or very few young. And so we had the idea very soon that we might be able to breed them.
Mm-hmm.
And if this would be possible,